like to discuss for a minute why I think that some crops are easier to do landrace gardening with than other crops. And the first thing, the first requirement that I have for being easy is it's something that makes seeds and it cross-pollinates easily. Crops that do that are really easy to adapt to landrace gardening because they're, the genetics are rearranging constantly, and so that makes them easy to work with. Fava beans, for example, have about a 30% cross-pollination rate, and so that's a good rate. You get lots of genetic diversity going on, and you know, about 70% of them are staying the same from year to year, and then you get the new varieties coming in, so that makes them really easy to work with. And the runner beans are the same way. They might cross at 35%. They're really attractive to hummingbirds, and the hummingbirds just poke their nose in there and trigger the cross-pollination mechanism. So runner beans work really good and are easy to work with. When I first started growing runner beans, I was growing only inbred varieties. And so if an inbred variety crosses with itself, it basically stays the same. And so they're not very nice for landrace gardening. But my friend Holly sent me some seeds that were a landrace from her garden down in California. And about 20% of those beans for me produced a crop. And so that was a really, that was the beginning of my landrace runner beans, because I had a genetically diverse crop to start with, and then they were cross-pollinating. Corn is the same way. In my garden, I expect corn to be about 50% cross-pollinating. That's really easy to work with, and it produces seeds in one generation. And any of the crops, like the cucumbers, the melons, the squash, they're easy to do landrace gardening with because of the high cross-pollination rates. And they're also a crop that occurs in a single generation. Spinach is really easy to do cross-pollination with because it's 100% outcrossing. There's male plants, there's female plants, and they have to cross-pollinate. And that's just part of the species characteristic, and so that makes them super easy to do. So people always ask me what crop they should be saving seeds from. What should they grow? And I'm like, grow what you love. If your heart's singing for fava beans, grow fava beans, or figure out how to grow fava beans. But if you hate fava beans, you don't like the taste, you don't like how they look, you don't like harvesting them when they're all black and corroded, if you don't like planting them the day after the snow melts, don't grow fava beans. Grow something that you love and you care about. So I really like working with the melons because since they have such a high cross-pollination rate, if I take, say, two of my favorite squashes and I allow them to cross-pollinate, the offspring will be generally tend towards being a halfway between the two parent varieties. And so I know what I'm going to get. It's going to be safe and comfortable. In a couple of years, the traits from those will switch places, so I might have a yellow banana squash to start out with, and it will turn into a green banana squash later on. But it's still a banana squash. It tastes like a banana squash. It cuts like a banana squash. It cooks like a banana squash. You know, there can be some diversity in there. Melons are really nice to work with that way because they're so, just they're changeable. And that's a really beautiful trait to work with. So the crops we just discussed are super easy to do landrace gardening with. And then there's some other crops that are easy, but they're a little bit more involved. For example, asparagus is a perennial, and so it makes seeds readily, but it's a little more difficult to develop a landrace for because you have several years that you have to grow it before it makes seeds. And that's okay, but instead of being a 3-year breeding project, it might turn into a 10-year breeding project. And so it's just slower and more gentle. Barley has a cross-pollination rate of around 10% in a super dry environment like mine. And so because of the low cross-pollination rate, pretty much if you grow a barley, it looks like every other barley, so it's hard to tell what the natural hybrids are. And so that can be a little more slow and gradual. The cabbage, kale, and broccoli, I classify as harder to do landrace development on because they're biennials. So you plant the seeds 1 year, and you harvest the seeds the next year. And so it's just a little more complicated. For example, at my place, I can't leave broccoli out in the garden over winter because it will winter kill. I have to store it somewhere in a place that's above freezing, but not too much moisture so it rots. So it's just more complicated. Eggplant has about a 10% cross-pollination rate. So if you pay attention, you can see the natural hybrids and pull them out, but it just requires paying attention and actually watching what's going on. The same thing with okra and peppers, because the cross-pollination rate's kind of low, and so you just gotta, you know, be more fussy about it. One thing about radishes that makes them a little bit harder is I want to pull up the root of the radish to inspect the root, and I want to taste it beforehand, and so that kind of disrupts the life cycle of the radish plants, which can be, you know, it just makes the process more complicated. Sunflowers have a cross-pollination rate of about 50%, which makes them great for a landrace development. Sometimes the sunflowers have male sterility, which can mess up the crop, and so you just got to pay more attention to make sure that your sunflowers are producing pollen and that kind of stuff. So tomatillos have a trait that makes them 100% outcrossing, and that can sometimes mess with our ideas of how crops should be growing, and you can't really save a tomatillo and expect it to be the same as its parent. And so that slows down the process because you're ending up selecting for family groups instead of finding one plant that you like to be the ancestor of the rest of them. So in tomatillos, just the natural diversity makes it harder to select any particular trait. And I've classified two different types of tomatoes as easy to work with. One I call pentamerous, which means that the flowers they're opened up and they can cross-pollinate easily with just things like bees. And so that makes them a nice cross-pollinating crop that is easy to work with. And then I have another category I call promiscuous tomatoes, and that's the ones that are 100% outcrossing. They can't cross with themselves, and those are also easy to do landrace development projects on once you get the 100% outcrossing trait stabilized. Then they end up in being like a tomatillo. They're a little harder than just a corner of squash. So the promiscuous tomatoes would be tomatoes that are descended from hybrids with wild tomatoes. And then wheat is another crop like barley, which it's easy to work with because it has about a 10% cross-pollination rate. But it's hard to see the genetic diversity in it. So you got to really focus and pay attention. Most of the crops that I call hard to work with are biennials because you grow the plant 1 year, you harvest the seed the next year. And for me in my cold mountain climate, that means that I have to dig the plant up, store it over winter in some place where it can be safe, and then replant it in the spring and harvest the seeds. And so it ends up becoming a big complicated procedure. So potatoes are hard because they got four sets of chromosomes running around, and each one of those is interacting with the others, and it's just complicated and messy, and any one of them can totally change how the plant grows and interacts. And then potatoes have a lot of sterility issues going on and clade interactions that one clade doesn't go with another. Sweet potatoes I put in the hard category because they've been cloned for so long that they lost their memory about how to make seeds. And so that takes a, you got to find varieties that can make seeds. Is for me, that's the most important criteria for growing sweet potatoes. Then domestic tomatoes only have a natural cross-pollination rate of around 3%. They're difficult to work with unless you're doing things like manual pollination. So on the very hard category, I put crops that hardly ever cross-pollinate, and that would be things like common beans, garbanzo beans. I put garlic on the list because garlic is another of those cloned crops. It's been cloned for so long that it forgot how to make seeds. There are varieties of garlic that do make seeds. Those are beautiful varieties to work with Landrace Gardening. And I put lettuce in the very hard category because of the 3% cross-pollination rate and because the flowers are little teeny tiny things. So it's really hard to do cross-pollination on them. The principles of Landrace Gardening apply just as equally to perennials and trees as they do to annual vegetables. The life cycle of a tree can be, say, 10 or 15 years between the time you plant the seed until you harvest the next generation of seed. The way I typically handle that, rather than trying to control everything, is just to send multitudes of plants out into the community, little tree seedlings, and then watch in my community 15 years later, go and knock on whoever's living in the house at that time and say, can I have some seeds from your nut tree? Perennials can be a little bit hard to work with because they're perennial, and so they become persistent in the garden, and you have to move the perennial bed from place to place each year so that you can tell the difference between the new seedlings and the old established crops. But other than that, it's the same principles apply. It's just letting them cross-pollinate and selecting among the offspring for what you love.